I'm leaning on the everlasting arms that placed me on the rock that stands. And I hold true to the one who breaks my fall and lifts me time and time again. Oh my God, you're so good. You never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. Oh my God, you're so good. You never give up, you never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love for me. Yeah. This freedom purchased by the highest price, this grace outweighing all my shame. And I'm made new through the power of sacrifice. From death and now raised to life again. Hey. Oh my God, you're so good. You never give up. You never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love. Because of your love for me. Oh my God, so good. You never give up. You never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love. Because of your love for me.
I'm not a slave.
I'm not a slave to sin. You are good. There we were, Christ, to rise in your freedom. You are good. You make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. Cause you are good. I praise your name as long as I'm breathing. Cause you're good.
I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing. You are good. Heavy with Christ to rise in your freedom. You are good. You make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. You are good. So I praise your name as long as I'm breathing.
Cause I'm good. Oh my God, you're so good. You never give up. You never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found. Because of your love for me. Oh my God,
so
you're
good.
So good.
Never give up on me.
Oh, what joy I found.
Because of your love for me.
Oh, oh my God,
God, so good. You never give up. You never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found. Because of your love. Because of your love for me.
Oh my God,
so good.
You never give up. Never give up on me.
Oh, what joy I found because of your love. Because of your love for me.
I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing.
You are good.
I was buried with Christ to rise in your freedom.
Because you are good.
But you make a promise, Jesus, you keep it.
You are good. So I praise your name as long as I'm breathing.
You are good.
Region. Please help us comply by wearing your mask at all times. I guess that's out in the foyer as well as in here. I don't know whether I could speak through my mask. Maybe I could. Let's see what happens here. Anyhow, as of today, we have met safety indoors for 26 weeks, and we thank you for your vigilance and cooperation, and thank the Lord for his protection. Continue to sit 3 seats apart from anyone unless you're family. Restricted rows are marked off, but there should be plenty of seats available, so really appreciate being able to do that. It's good to be obedient to what they're asking us to do. We're ready to praise the Lord. We're in tune. We're sync. So why don't we just stand up and let's bless God tonight. Father, we're going to bless you tonight and give you praise and thank you for being our Father, being the one who loves us. Thank you, Lord God, for watching over us. And we thank you, Father, that you're quick to forgive. You're ready to forgive and abundantly pardon us. We thank you for that, Father. We graciously appreciate that in Jesus' name. Amen.
Good to see everybody. Please stand if you can.
I am holding on to faith, 'cause I know you'll make a way. I don't always understand, I don't always get to see, but I will believe it, I will believe it. Sing this out. You make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. Forever faithful you are, faithful now. I'm standing on your word, calling heaven down to earth. Now you will fight my enemies, this will end in victory. I will believe it, Lord, I will believe it. 'Cause you make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. Now I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. Yes, I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. Yes, I know that I know you never fail. Yes, I know that I know you never will. 'Cause you make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise to shake prison walls. Now I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my time. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You make mountains move, you make giants fall, you use songs of praise, shake prison walls. I will speak to my fear, I will preach to my doubt. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now. You were faithful then, you'll be faithful now.
Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. You know, I like to talk about perspective a lot. And, you know, when I think about this, oh, there's another mandate now. hey, we can still meet, guys. We can still come. You know, it makes me think about the persecuted church across the world that have to meet underground. They've been doing that for decades and decades and decades. We still have so much freedom here. Let's praise God for what we do have and stop complaining about what we don't. We can still meet. I know you're mumbling through the mask and trying to sing, but I don't need to hear you. God needs to hear you. You're singing for him. You're not singing for us up here. Hallelujah. But let's be thankful. The minute we stop being thankful is the minute we lose our joy, and the minute we lose our joy is the minute we lose the strength of God. So come on now. Let's keep praising through this crap. Amen. I've seen your grace from the mountain. I felt you there in this valley below. I see your love and your mercy. You're guiding me home. I know you're in every season. I feel your hand bringing peace and control. Jesus, your love is my anchor. You're my only hope. You're my only hope. And I will trust in you. I will not be moved.
Hey!
High on the mountain, I will be lifting my voice.
And in the valley,
I will be dancing for joy. In every season, you are worthy. In every moment, wonderful. I hope our redemption, your presence is here. Your presence is here. And I will trust in you. I will not be moved. High on the mountain, I will be lifting my voice. And in the valley, I will be dancing for joy. In every season, you are worthy. In every moment, wonderful, you're wonderful, wonderful, wonderful. We won't be silent, our hearts on fire. Jesus, our victory, the sound of triumph, the song inside us. Jesus, our victory, we won't be silent, our hearts on fire. Jesus, our victory, the sound of triumph, the song inside us. Dancing for joy in every season. You are worthy in every moment. Wonderful, wonderful, wonderful.
mountain, I will be lifting my voice. And in this valley, I will be dancing for joy. Cause in every season, you are worthy. In every moment, wonderful. Wonderful, you're wonderful.
Thank you, Lord. Father, help us to speak a word in season to him that is weary, Father. Father, we thank you that that's your desire, to touch people's lives and hearts, restore them, make them whole again, Father. In Jesus' name. So we come before you tonight, Father. Thank you for the anointing of God in this place tonight. For those of you who watch on Facebook, we want you to know Jesus loves you. He's got an awesome plan for your life. And we'll just say hello to Melissa up in Grove City watching. And we just want you to know that God loves you, and he's going to be present with you right there tonight, where you are right now. So, Father, thank you for ministering to people. We thank you for breaking bondages in people's lives, eradicating fears and condemnation, eradicating the failure syndrome, Father, and helping them to have a new image in you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, thanks, and I give you thanks for all you've done. I am so blessed, and I am so blessed. My soul is at rest, oh Lord, and I give you thanks.
Let's sing that together. I give thanks.
Thanks, thanks, and I give you thanks for all you've done. I am so blessed, and I am so blessed. My soul is at rest, oh Lord, and I give you
one more time. Let's sing it together.
Oh, and thanks, thanks, oh, I give you thanks for blessed. My soul is at rest, oh Lord, I give you thanks, oh Lord, I give you thanks.
We give thanks to you, Lord.
Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, yeah. Jesus the name. Jesus the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you, we live for you, we live for you. Oh, holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Yeah. Jesus, the name above every other name.
Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. Oh, we live for you. Oh, and holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes and wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. Help us to be the church tonight, Lord. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. I will build my upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be, I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my and wonder and show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me and your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone, and I will not be shaken. We're not going to be shaken, Lord. We're not going to be shaken, Lord. Thank you for the peace that passes all understanding, that keeps and guards our minds and hearts through Christ Jesus. We receive the joy of the Lord. Be in our strength, Lord. You worthy, you are worthy, you are worthy of our praise. Thank you, Lord. You're the miracle working God. I pray divine protection over each one listening, each one here tonight, Lord. With long life, you'll satisfy us. In Jesus' name.
Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for Brenda and Jesse and Shay and John who are watching tonight. Father, we ask that you minister to them right now where they are, Father. That your presence is just as strong there as it is here, Father. We thank you that in your presence is fullness of joy. And at your right hand are pleasures forevermore. Thank you, Father. Oh, yes. Thank you that the glory of the latter house shall be greater than the former. Oh, glory to God. Thank you, Father, the glory. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Well, it looks kind of like the glory clouds in here tonight. I just want you to know the building's not on fire. You see that smoke? It's just a little fog left over from the Swamp Junk concert that was here Friday night. Glory to God. Amen. Hallelujah. Well, let's rejoice tonight in Jesus. He's our reason for going on. He's our reason for rejoicing. Glory to God. He's the one to whom we look. You know, they said in 2 Chronicles chapter 20, Lord, we don't know what to do. We do not know what to do, but our eyes are upon you. Thank you, Lord. Woo! Getting ready to run again. We don't know what to do. Listen, when you don't know what to do, make sure your eyes are upon Him, the center of our lives. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Somebody got a testimony tonight? God's done a miracle in your life? Anybody at all? He's done a miracle? Anybody? Okay. All right, what has He done for you, hon?
He's healing me, slow but sure, and I'm thankful for it.
And you're
difficulty in my back with muscles and things.
And it's going away, and you're sensing mobility?
Yes.
Agility?
Yes.
And a pain-free existence?
That's right.
Amen. Come on, let's praise Him for it. Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Oh, you are so good. Well, Father, we pray for this great nation. We pray for Mr. Trump, Pence, Kavanaugh, Gorsuch, Bill Barr, Durham, Horowitz, Mike Pompeo, all of them, Father. And God, we pray right now that your protection would be upon all of them, that they would have the leading of the Spirit, Father, that they would have the wisdom of Almighty God coming upon them, and that they would have wisdom in the counsel of many. And Father, we pray for a mighty move of God in America. Lord, that there be a spiritual awakening, Father, a spiritual renewal, Father, in America. Oh, God, we praise you now and thank you for spiritual renewal in Israel as well, Father, in Jesus' name. Thank you for revival in the churches of America, Father. We love you, Lord Jesus, and we praise you tonight. We praise you, Lord Jesus. Thank you, Father. Bring us back, God, to your plumb line. Bring us back to your moral compass, oh God. We pray in Jesus' name. And Father, we ask that you would defeat the enemies of Israel, defeat Hamas, Hezbollah, Fatah, PLO, Al-Qaeda, Al-Jazeera, ISIS, and ISIL. Thank you, Father, for spreading the gospel throughout the 1040 window nations, Father, of the world. Thank you for doing it, Lord. Those nations in that 1040 latitude area, all of those Arab nations, Muslim nations, Father, we ask that you would reveal yourself to them. Give them a personal encounter with you, Lord. How many want a personal encounter with Jesus? Because when you encounter him, you'll never be the same, guaranteed. When you've sensed his presence and you've had a personal encounter with him. The Bible says, acquaint now thyself with him. It's in Job 22, 21. Acquaint now thyself with him and what? Be at peace. When you get acquainted with him, you're going to be at peace. Peace from the Prince of Peace. Peace that passes all understanding. Peace. Everybody say peace. Through acquainting ourselves with him. That's not superficial acquaintance. That means you come to know him. And then it goes on to say, thereby shall good come unto you. In the Hebrew, the word good there means supply. Are you in need of some supply tonight? Supply from the one that has the riches in glory by Christ Jesus? Thereby good or supply will come unto you. If you're in need of supply, just begin to praise him for it right now. Thank him that he's brought you into a wealthy place and that he is commanding the blessing in your storehouses. Commanding the blessing in your storehouses. Oh, we praise you, Lord Jesus. You're so good. Well, that's a good scripture to take an offering up on, all right? Glory be to God. Thank you, Lord. Let's go ahead, ushers, if you would, go ahead and pass out the sheet, the envelopes, and fill out your envelopes, and you spell million, M-I-L-L-I-O-N. You never know, you just might have a millionaire in the service. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, I like that scripture in Habakkuk chapter 1, verse 5 that says, behold, ye among the heathen, and regard and wonder marvelously. He says, for I will work a work in you. I will work a work in your days which ye will not believe, though it be told you. God is about to work a work in America. The people are not going to believe it, even though it's told them. I said, God is about to work a work in America and in your lives that you will not believe, even though it's told you. You say, I can't believe that. Oh, my goodness. God did something radical here. Are you ready for a move of God?
Yeah.
Oh, me too. Thank you, Lord. The glory of the latter house is going to be greater than the former. I will work a work in your days which you will not believe, though it be told you. Glory to God. I can hardly wait. Thank you, Father, for this offering tonight. We praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Go ahead and give tonight if you would, and pass the buckets, gentlemen, and we'll just praise him some more.
I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing, you are good. Bear we with Christ to rise in your freedom. You are good. You make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. You are good. I praise your name as long as I'm breathing. You are good. Come on. I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing. You are good. Bear we with Christ to rise in your freedom. You are good, Lord. You make a promise, Jesus, you'll keep it. Cause you are good. I'll praise your name as long as I'm breathing. You are good, yeah. Oh my God, you're so good. You never give up. You never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love. Because of your love for me. Oh my God.
Good.
Oh, what joy I
find. Oh,
my God, you're so good. You never give up. You never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love. Because of your love for me. Oh, my God, you're so good. Never give up. Never give up on me. Oh, what joy I found because of your love. Because of your love. I'm not a slave to sin, so I'm singing, you are good. Bear we with Christ to rise in your freedom. You are good, you are so. You make a promise, Jesus, you keep it. Cause you are good, Lord. I praise your name as long as I'm breathing. You are good, you are so good. You are so good.
Glory to God. Glory to God. Well, let's wish Matt and Maria a wonderful, happy anniversary. Come on. I just had an anniversary yesterday. Hey, and let's wish it Jessica Wood. Happy birthday. All right, Jessica. All right. Praise the Lord. Well, give someone a virtual fist pump. Did we miss any other birthdays? Anybody else? Okay. Well, ushers, if you would, help me pass these out today. Glory to God. Good to see all of you tonight. We're going to get into the Word tonight. How many love to learn things from the Word? Amen. Me too. Because the more information that you get, I'm going to switch over to this other mic now. The more information you get from the Word of God, the more knowledge you have, the more peace you're going to have in your life. The Bible says grace and peace are multiplied to us through what? Through the knowledge of God. Where do you get the knowledge of God? From reading the book about His attributes and His character. So the more knowledge you get about God, the more peace you're going to have in your life. And the Bible says, great peace have they which love thy law. Oh, how many love His Word tonight. You're going to have great peace in your life. Well, turn with me in your Bibles to John chapter 5. John chapter 5. In verse 28, and we're going to be full of peace tonight because we're going to get some Word tonight. Hey, Arnt, did you hear about the astronaut, the Christian astronaut who just took off? Listen to this. Astronaut Vic Glover wasn't trying to get away from God as he blasted the International Space Station in the SpaceX Crew Dragon's capsule Resilience on Sunday. As the first African-American astronaut to go on a long-term mission, Vic Glover, took on board communion cups and the Word of God. He plans to utilize a strong internet connection aboard the craft to access, listen, faith-based programs. While he's in outer space, going around there, they're going to be there for 5 to 6 months. Glover arrived at the ISS with three other crew members aboard the first commercially developed space vehicle certified by NASA. Those other astronauts were two other ones were Americans and one was Japanese. The FAA to ferry astronauts to low Earth orbit and back again. The crew will stay at the space station until the spring. Along with reading his Bible and praying, the 44-year-old said a video interview with a certain church, he plans to participate in a virtual service and virtual giving. Can you imagine pushing the button for virtual giving from outer space? Come on, that ought to encourage us who live down the street. Glory to God. Glover made his first tweet aboard the Resilience just about 1 p.m. Eastern on Monday. It says, "Go Crew Dragon, go Resilience. Big thank you to the teams at NASA and SpaceX for keeping us safe on the ride up. Next stop, Space Station," he wrote, attaching several pictures of the blastoff. Aren't you glad we got a Christian astronaut up there in that space station? Isn't that awesome? Father, thank you for your word tonight. We ask you to illuminate it in our hearts in Jesus' name. John chapter 5 and verse 28 says this, "Marvel not at this, for the hour is coming in the which all that are in the graves shall hear his voice." All that are in the graves, even the dead, even those who were unbelievers. Because at some point they're going to come out and they're going to stand judgment at the white throne judgment. We're not going to be at that one. We're going to be at the Bema seat. All right, we're going to be at the judgment seat of Christ, where the rewards are passed out. Now, we won't be at the white throne judgment, and the unsaved won't be at the Bema seat. Isn't that something? So, it says, all are going to hear the sound of his voice, and shall hear his voice, and shall come forth they that have done good unto the resurrection of life, and they that have done evil unto the resurrection of damnation. So that's the white throne judgment, the damnation. Revelation, here's the scriptures for it. Revelation chapter 20, verses 10 to 15. In fact, you want to take a look at that? Let's look at it. Revelation 20, verses 10 to 15. Let's look at it. Revelation 20, 10. See what it says there. You're about to get blessed because you're reading the book of Revelation. Amen. Revelation 20:10 says, "And the devil that deceived them was cast into the lake of fire and brimstone, where the beast and the false prophet are, and shall be tormented day and night forever and ever. And I saw a great white throne, and him that sat on it, from whose face the earth and the heaven fled away, and there was found no place for them." The white throne judgment. Who's that? The judge of all the earth is sitting enthroned there. "And I saw the dead, small and great, stand before God, and the books were open, and another book was open, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged out of those things which were written in the books according to their works." The book of life. We got to make sure our book name is in the book of life. You say, how's that happen? By asking Jesus to be the Lord of your life, believing in your heart, confessing with your mouth, making Jesus the Lord. That's how you get in the book of life, and that's how we're going to be judged by Jesus. We're judged in Jesus. Then it goes on to say, "And the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and the death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them. And they were judged every man according to their works." You can check that out too in Matthew 16:27. "And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death. And whosoever was not found written in the book of life was cast into the lake of fire." So, here you see in front of you, we passed this sheet out. This gives you a general overview of what's going to happen. We're going to be raptured out of here. Then we're going to be in heaven. Move that horizontal line. That's where it says heaven. That's where we are for 7 years. While on the earth, beginning with the tribulation, beginning at the end of this age, is going to come the tribulation, which is told about in Matthew chapter 24:21. And also mentioned as Jacob's trouble in, Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. Well, at the end of that period, 7 year period, the end of the tribulation, the end of that 7 year period in heaven, Jesus is going to come back and step foot on the earth, and there's going to be a battle of Armageddon. Satan is going to be cast into the bottomless pit. There's going to be a 1,000-year reign of Christ, and then there's going to come the white throne judgment that we just now read about. Then after that, Satan is going to be cast into the lake of fire. So, here we see it, and Jesus talks about it here himself in verse 29, that they will be raised to the resurrection of damnation. So, let's go over to the book of Daniel, chapter 12 and verse 10. Daniel chapter 12, verse 10. I get excited about reading the Bible, don't you? Oh, glory to God. Daniel chapter 12, verse 10. Thank you, Lord Jesus. If you love his word, shout amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Daniel chapter 12 and verse 10 says this. Daniel 12, verse 10 says, many shall be purified and made white and tried, but the wicked shall do wickedly. And none of the wicked shall understand, but the wise shall understand. I said the wicked are not going to understand, but the wise are going to understand. The wicked are not going to see some things that you believers are going to see, and you're going to understand some things that they will not grasp concerning the end times. And so, go over there with me to Revelation chapter 8. Revelation chapter 8. So you see, this book has been unveiled to the believers in these end times. That's what Daniel was saying there. He's saying the wise are going to understand it, and the unwise or the heathen are not. Revelation chapter 8, verses 10 to 13. Notice what it says here. Revelation 8 and verse 10 says, in the third angel, Revelation 8, 10, going to be a lot of wild things go on during the tribulation period. We know, so that talks about a mountain that's going to be burning in the book of Revelation. You know what that is? That's a volcano. You ever see a mountain that's burning? You ever see a side of a mountain get blown out? That's a volcanic eruption. And so it says in verse 10, it says, and the third angel sounded, and there fell a great star from heaven, burning as it were a lamp. And it fell upon the third part of the rivers and upon the fountains of waters. And the name of the star, now remember it says a star fell. Is that an asteroid? Is that a comet? Is it a meteor? What is it? It says in this name of the star is called Wormwood. Everybody say Wormwood. Now, Wormwood means bitter, or it means calamity. And it says a third part of the earth is going to be affected by this thing. As it falls on the earth, Wormwood, a star, or some sort of a comet or meteor, asteroid perhaps, is going to fall on the earth and do cataclysmic destruction on the earth. And you say, well, this seems pretty far out to me. Well, you know, it happened back in 1908 over there in Russia. You ever heard of the Siberian desert? Well, it's not a desert. It's Siberia is pretty desolate, right? In a place called the Tomaska Forest in Siberia in 1908, an asteroid hit that area. It's a wilderness area with just a bunch of trees, but it covered 700 square miles when that asteroid hit. That's because it was about 27 miles in diameter. And it just took a big swath out of that whole area. Thank God it was not a populated area. You say 27 miles in diameter. That'd be like from here to Greater Pittsburgh Airport, 27 miles in diameter. This actually happened. Presently, we have no technology to deflect such an asteroid that would come to this Earth, or a way to disintegrate it, but it would destroy much life. Scientists are constantly tracking these asteroids and comets and meteors and so forth for potential hits from those asteroids. Debris from that asteroid in our atmosphere would cut off the sun for months. And you know where the safest place to be would be? Probably up on that space station with our buddy Vic Glover. Amen. Hallelujah. You might want to sign up for SpaceX. Take a trip, huh? Turn with me to Revelation chapter 2. So he's warning us in the book of Revelation how we can avoid such things. He's speaking to the churches, and he gives them some admonitions and some warnings and so forth. In Revelation chapter 2, beginning with verse 4, he says, "Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember, therefore, from whence thou art fallen, and repent, and do the first works." What are the first works? Loving Jesus. Out of a love for him. "Do the first works, or else I will come unto thee quickly, and I will remove thy candlestick out of his place, except thou repent." Go to chapter 2, verse 14. It says, "But I have a few things against thee." This is another church now he's speaking to. "I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed unto idols, and to commit fornication. So hast thou them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans." I didn't say Nicolaitans. I said Nicolaitans, "which thing I hate." Said they were holding to false doctrines. And actually, this church that he's speaking about here was in the area of Turkey. And listen, here's some of the things that were taking place. And I got some of this from Rick Renner. I heard Rick Renner say that the people, the Christians there, were being persuaded or influenced to worship in these heathen temples where they burn incense to the goddess of Diana. And they would say, "Oh, come on, it won't hurt. Come on, you can burn a little incense to the goddess Diana. You can still be a Christian and do this." And the Lord didn't like it one bit. You know why? Because he's a jealous God. He says, "I will have no other gods before me, and I will not have a split allegiance with some other god." They say, "Oh, come on. Here's a little metal statue of Diana. You can bow down and worship that. It won't hurt a thing. You can still be a Christian and do that." No, God says, "Uh-uh. I'll have no other gods before me." There was a divided allegiance. And then over there in verse 20, look at verse 20. It says, "Notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And I give her space to repent for her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they repent of their deeds." She's going to experience great tribulation. Now, we teach on this not to scare you, but to prepare you, to enable you to get prepared. Because it's not okay to fornicate. God says she's destined to great tribulation. And listen, anything that pertains to the dark side is not of God. So steer clear of anything from the kingdom of darkness, witchcraft, occult, black magic, or speaking words about yourself that are contrary to God's word. Don't say those things. "Oh, I'm just a loser. I'm just a louse. I'm a big zero." Huh? You're opposing what God says about you. "I'm a big failure. I'll never do anything." Huh? You're talking against the word of God. You say, "Well, what can I do, Pastor?" Well, look at the book of Colossians. So he says, avoid those things that are of the kingdom of darkness. Don't even flirt with them. No, I will not allow you to have a mixed allegiance here. Colossians 3:17 says, and whatsoever you do in word or deed, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God and the Father by Him. If what you're about to do, you cannot do in the name of Jesus, don't do it.
Amen.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
So ask yourself, this next thing that I'm about to do, can I do it to His glory? If you can't, don't do it. Hallelujah. The Bible says, whatsoever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord and not unto men.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen. You're in Christ. So don't give any place to the devil. Ephesians 4:27 says, give no place to the devil. Don't give an open door. Oh, I don't believe in the devil. You're just the very one he's going to seduce. Man, I've seen many people in the denominational church say, oh, I just don't believe there's a devil. And they're the very ones that the devil is manipulating and influencing. The Bible tells us we ought to hate evil and love good. And if you're allowing evil from the dark side, renounce it. Because listen, look at your chart there. Once we're in heaven with Jesus for 7 years, what's going to happen? We're going to come back with Him, glory to God. Look what it says in Mark 13:24. Mark 13. All those of you watching by Facebook tonight, take heed to this word because God loves you. Take it as a love letter to you that He's giving you caution about the things that would trip you up and seduce you, and don't give place to those things in your life. Mark 13:24 says, but in those days after that tribulation, after the end of the tribulation, look on your chart there, what happens at the end of the tribulation? The sun shall be darkened, and the moon shall not give her light. And the stars of heaven shall fall, and the powers that are in heaven shall be shaken. And then shall they see the Son of Man coming in the clouds with great power and glory. That's when the Son of Man's going to come. In great power and glory. At the end of all this devastation that begins at the mid-tribulation period after 3.5 years from the end of the age. Go with me to Revelation chapter 17. Revelation chapter 17. You say, what are you preaching on, Pastor? I'm preaching on prepare to fly number 3. Prepare to fly number 3. Hallelujah. Prepare to fly. I was thinking of that astronaut. It reminded me of when I did fly. I had this buddy. And we'd fly around different places in Ohio and different places, go out for what you call a $100 hamburger, down to Carrollton, Ohio, or out to Salem or someplace. But we'd always minister to somebody. We'd always pass out tracts. We'd always tell people about Jesus. We got some people saved. And we called it Sky Ministries. Sky Ministries. And so we got a lot of good memories. I'm gonna see that fellow, that pilot, tomorrow morning. But we used to fly together and just had a great time. Sky Ministries. Yeah, I better get back here to the word. Thinking about flying here. Anyhow, but it was fun. We mixed the word with it. See, everywhere you go. Listen, don't just compartmentalize Jesus and keep Him in church and then not have Him be a part of your life wherever you go. He ought to be part everywhere you go. Everything that you do, whatsoever you do, do it heartily as unto the Lord. Amen? Hallelujah. Revelation 19. Oh, no, Revelation 17. Well, I started to read that, didn't I? Did I give you verse Revelation 17:14? Notice what it says here. These shall make war with the Lamb, and the Lamb shall overcome them. That's at the Battle of Armageddon that you see on your chart there. For He is Lord of lords and King of kings, and they that are with Him are called and chosen and faithful. Guess what you are? You are called, you're chosen, and you are faithful, and you're going to be with Him when He comes back, riding a white horse. And you're going to be on chargers as well, following our leader, glory to God, back to this earth, Back to the Mount of Olives. Hallelujah. Amen. Glory be to God. Revelation 19, verse 13. Revelation 19, 13. And he was clothed with a vesture dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. And the armies which were in heaven followed him upon white horses, clothed in fine linen, white and clean. And out of his mouth goeth a sharp sword, and with it should smite the nations. And he shall rule them with a rod of iron, and he treadeth the winepress of the fierceness of the wrath of Almighty God. And he hath on his vesture and on his thigh a name written, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Oh, that's Jesus that we're talking about. And at the end of that tribulation period, when he comes back, he's going to step foot, as I said, on the Mount of Olives. He's going to be in Jerusalem, and we're going to return with him, and he's going to set up his kingdom. And he's going to come back, and we're going to be with him in like manner as he went up. He's going to come back. Mount of Olives in Jerusalem. Set up his kingdom in the capital of Jerusalem. Do you know Jerusalem has been destroyed 36 times? Everybody say 36. Jerusalem, the city, has been destroyed 36 times in 6,000 years. This is in an area of the world that acts as a land bridge. Here's Israel and going west, you got Europe. Going east, you got Asia. Going south, you got Africa. So it's become a land bridge for these great continents and these great areas of land, Europe, Asia, and Africa. And Israel was possessed by the Canaanites at one time. Seven different nations owned it prior to Joshua crossing the river and crossing the Jordan River, going into Canaan land. But Jerusalem means peace. You hear the word Salem? Jerusalem? Salem means peace. But listen, Israel has experienced nothing, no peace all these years. They had the Crusades there in 1099 to 1187. And the Jews, many Jews were burned alive. But God says concerning Israel, look at Isaiah chapter 62. Isaiah chapter 62. Are you getting something out of this tonight? Isaiah 62 and verse 7. No, verse 1. Isaiah 62, 1. Let's see here. 62, 1. For Zion's sake will I not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest. God says, I will not rest until what? Until the righteousness thereof go forth as brightness, and the salvation thereof as a lamp burneth. And he says in, 62:1, and then let's see what it says in 62:7. It says, and give him no rest until he establish, until he make Jerusalem a praise in the earth. God's wanting to make Jerusalem a rest, a peace in the earth. And God is going to do it. That's right. Supernaturally, he's going to do it. Jerusalem, do you know the word Jerusalem appears 766 times in the Bible? That's a lot. And God says in Joel chapter 3, verse 2, he says, Jerusalem must not be divided. Our presidents, all of them, past, future, need to read that scripture and not allow Jerusalem to be divided. It's already East Jerusalem. We have the mosque there, Al-Aqsa Mosque and everything. But he says, I don't want it to be divided. East Jerusalem already is a temple mount. He doesn't want it to be divided into Palestinian territory. So we've got the chart right in front of us. We see the overview of what's going to happen. It's really, do you know that 36% of the Christians believe in the pre-tribulation rapture? 36%. 4% believe in the mid-tribulation rapture, and 18% believe in a post-tribulation rapture. So, the pre-tribulation rapture has the most support scripturally of any of those. More scriptures refer to the pre-tribulation than anything else. And the pre-tribulation rapture was taught right from the first century. So this isn't something new that was dreamed up or dreamed up by John Darby. Amen. No, it was preached clear back in the first century. So we're preparing to go. And do you know that 18% of Americans believe the world will end in their lifetime? 18%. 10%, the word believers, are watching for his return. Are you watching for his return? Are you looking for the blessed hope? Boy, I am. Glory to God. And we have another sign, which is the regathering of the Jews from 1889 to 1991. Or maybe that was 1989 to, I don't know, maybe I got my dates wrong here, to 1991. There has been this regathering of the Jews back to Jerusalem, Jeremiah 16, 15. So, you say, what do we do in this last day? Let me finish this up. Here's what we're going to do. We're going to, in this last day, we must rely on the power of the Holy Spirit to be sustained. As he says, he that endures to the end shall be saved in Matthew chapter 12. Amen. Stay full of the Holy Ghost. Don't give up, praise God. Glory to God. Why do I say that? Because, listen, don't turn back and don't quit. Like somebody said, hangest thou in there. Quitting is not an option. Amen? Persevere and outlast the devil. And just dig your heels in and say, if anybody's going to quit, it ain't going to be me. It's going to be the devil. All right? And listen to these scriptures and out of the Message Bible in Hebrews 12:1. Notice what it says here. Hebrews 12:1, it says, all these pioneers who blazed the way, all these veterans cheering us on, it means we'd better get on with it. Strip down, start running, and never quit. That's what the Message Bible says. Ephesians 1:6 says this, there has never been the slightest doubt in my mind that God, who started this great work in you, would keep at it and bring you to a flourishing finish on the very day Christ Jesus appears. That's what we're looking for, right? The day that Jesus appears. Let's stand tonight. Glory to God. Well, there's no quit in your spirit. No, we're not going to give up. We're going to endure to the end. We know what's going to happen. And when you know, we understand 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 to 13 to 18, we're going to comfort one another with these words. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. And in the meantime, we're going to get every person in the kingdom that we possibly can. That's right. There's going to be a pre-rapture harvest of souls, and we're doing it right now. We're take those tracks. Brother Gail's got them loaded up in his pocket right here. And you just say, if you get a chance, check that out. I'll tell you some good news. And if you pray that prayer in the back, it'll be your best year ever. Amen. My wife and I talked to a bank manager today, and we gave him one. Told him to pray that prayer in the back. It'll be your best year ever. He says, well, thank you. I will. I'll take that. I'll give this back to Gil.
Thank you.
That's like gold, huh? Father, thank you tonight for your goodness. And listen, those of you who say, I've watched this, and I heard what you said, Pastor, and I don't want to go through that devastating time where wormwood might hit, or where there's volcanic activity, and where there's going to be devastation and people dying. No, I don't want to go through that. You don't have to, because Jesus shed his blood so that you and I could be forgiven of our sins and go in that rapture. Notice that first line, it comes down. Jesus is coming to this earth, into the clouds, and we're going to go up and meet him, glory to God. Here's all you have to do. Here's what you have to do. Believe in your heart. Say this with me right now. Heavenly Father, I believe with all my heart, Jesus is the Son of God. Jesus, come into my heart. Be the Lord of my life. Thank you for forgiving me of all my past sins. Thank you for loving me. Thank you for saving me. And thank you for a first-class plan for my life. In Jesus' name, amen. I don't know about you, but I like to fly. And when we get raptured out of here, we're going to go. So are you prepared to fly? That's the last message I'm going to do on that one, that series, Prepared to fly. So get all three of them and pass them on to some people that don't know Jesus. Amen? Amen. Because he loves you and he's got a wonderful plan. God bless you. Have a great evening. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.